All right, if I could have your attention again, we will proceed with our program this afternoon. Hope you have enjoyed your lunch. Please do continue enjoying your dessert and coffee. In just a moment, I'm going to invite Eleanor up to introduce our featured speaker. But it has become somewhat of a tradition when we invite someone like Todd Buchholz back to Young America's Foundation to address an audience, someone who, with a history going back several years with Young America's Foundation, has become somewhat of a tradition, I think enjoyed by all, save perhaps the speaker, him or herself, to dig through the Foundation archives and prove to you, when we say someone is an alumni, that Ron had his finger on the pulse of the movement and was able to identify rising stars from their earliest days. So I think, do we have a few pictures to flash up on the screen there? I think Todd is maybe third from the left. Yeah, oh, look at that, the blue, yes, yeah, that's very, I did warn Todd that we may have something like this in the works, and he threatened to depart from the center and get on his train immediately, but we did it all the same. Well, it is such a cult who's done so much for our cause as an alum of Young America's Foundation, and to be able to welcome here to the Reagan Ranch Center and to do that more formally and professionally, I would like to invite Eleanor Linton to the stage. Eleanor is a graduate of Grove City College. She hails from Pennsylvania. Originally, she studied political science and biblical and religious studies at Grove City, and she now serves as a development officer with Young America's Foundation. She was actually first introduced to our work in a fashion similar to, I bet, to many of you, and that was through the publication distribution of the Reagan Ranch calendars. So please welcome Eleanor to introduce our speaker.
Thank you. It's my pleasure to introduce Todd Buchholz to you. He is a best-selling author of several books about the economy, including the just released The Price of Prosperity, which we used to help promote today, and we have copies for sale after the lunch. He also wrote New Ideas from Dead CEOs, Lasting Lessons from the Corner Office, and Rush, Why You Need and Love the Rat Race. For Buchholz brings a sharp, entertaining wit to the study of economics. For him, it's all about connecting the dots to make smart, informed decisions. He correctly forecasted the 2001 slowdown in the U.S. financial markets, the 2008 pop in commodity prices, and the 2011 downgrade of the U.S. debt rating in editorials in the Wall Street Journal and in commentary on PBS and NPR. Buchholz has written articles for the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, the Washington Post, Forbes, and Reader's Digest. As a keynote speaker and guest lecturer, Buchholz has addressed the White House, Microsoft, IBM, Goldman Sachs, and the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. From 1989 to 1992, he served the White House as a director for economic policy. Buchholz won the Alan Young Teaching Prize at Harvard and holds advanced degrees from Harvard and Cambridge. He was a fellow at Cambridge University in 2009, holds several engineering and design patents, and is co-producer of the Broadway smash Jersey Boys. Buchholz has authored numerously acclaimed and best-selling books, many of which he has developed into successful lectures and speaking events. His books have been translated into a dozen languages and are used in universities worldwide, including Harvard, Duke, and Princeton. Buchholz is praised for his examination of economics, business, and entrepreneurship in the context of global society. The Wall Street Journal named The Price of Prosperity, Why Rich Nations Fail and How to Renew Them, to its exclusive list of 8 summer must-reads for this past summer 2016. I've started reading the book and was surprised to find that one of the first sections of the book quotes from the 1942 classic movie Casablanca. If you think economics can't be entertaining, think again. You are in for a real treat this afternoon. Please join me in welcoming Todd Buchholz to the stage.
Well, Thank you, Eleanor. Thank you. It's great to be back here in Santa Barbara. It's nice to have a kids' table, you know? And it's like being at a wedding. You guys are near the speakers, right? Because you don't mind if it gets really loud. It's great to be here in Santa Barbara, in this state of California. So many wonderful people have come from California. Robert Frost, Joe DiMaggio. Right? Some wonderful, extraordinary people. No, Joe DiMaggio from San Francisco. George Washington was from California. Seriously, he was from some Virginians, you know. No, he was from California. In fact, he chopped down his cherry tree in California. In fact, it wasn't a cherry tree, it was a redwood. And his father confronted young George and said, "George, did you chop down that tree?" And George said, Father, I did. I cannot tell a lie. And his father said, "Well, then, George, if you cannot tell a lie, you better pack your bags and move to Virginia because you don't have a future in California politics." It really is wonderful to be back here at YAF. As Eleanor or Andrew had pointed out, I had actually been an intern for YAF many, many years ago. My eldest daughter was an intern here at the Reagan Ranch, and my two younger daughters, who are currently in high school, attended the YAF program last spring. You know, and it would be wonderful, truly, and Ron and I discussed this the other day, it would be wonderful if we could say, it's not necessary. It'd be wonderful if you could have an enjoyable lunch and then we say, all right, be on your way, you don't need to come back, because high school students and college students are now getting to hear conservative points of view from their teachers and their professors. And that when names like Ronald Reagan and Milton Friedman and Friedrich von Hayek are mentioned in school, that the teachers show respect. Sadly, that's not the case. So sadly, we have work to do, and you are all part of it. And there are few things you can do to ensure freedom in this country, few things more important than supporting organizations like Young America's Foundation. So I'm especially pleased to be here today and to talk about this book, The Price of Prosperity. That's my father, 17 years old, World War II. At age 17, he insists that his father bring him down to the recruitment station, and he joins the war and serves in the South Pacific. As I saw that video of the 9/11 commemorations, and I'm glad I didn't have to speak at that moment because I was getting choked up. I remember so many Memorial Day parades when I was growing up as a kid. And my dad would march in the American Legion parade, and there'd be, you know, I remember the hot dogs and things like that afterwards. But my dad taught my brother and my sister and me, that the proper thing to do as you saw the flag pass was to put your hand on your heart. Well, now we live in a country where very few people do that. But at best, they may pay some attention to the American flag. And what I discovered in this book is that this is not a uniquely American problem. It's not a uniquely 21st century problem. Throughout history, well, let's put it this way. Lots of people have written about how poor countries fall apart. And you can get lots of articles about Syria and South Sudan and so on. Very few people have grappled with the following. Rich countries fall apart throughout history. We recently celebrated my wife's grandmother's 101st birthday a couple weeks ago. When she was born, there was an Ottoman Empire, and there was a Habsburg Empire, and they controlled North Africa, the Middle East, and Middle Europe, and they're gone. They're gone. There's no guarantee that this country will withstand the gale forces coming from abroad and from within. Again, just reminiscing about when I was growing up on the Jersey Shore, which is where our friend Mark had grown up. I remember my dad flipping hamburgers when I was a little kid, and because it was the Jersey Shore, we were swatting mosquitoes as he flipped the burgers. And one neighbor says to my dad, "Well, if Nixon gets elected, I'm moving to Canada." And then another, you know, a few years later, well, if Carter gets elected, I'm moving to Reagan. Well, if Reagan gets elected, I'm moving. So I'm thinking, as a kid, Canada must be a really crowded place by now. But it's not. Why? Because my dad's friends were bluffing, right? I mean, you know, it was the Rheingold beer and the Mai Tais and the summer nights. And, you know, sure, they were just bluffing about this. But now, for the first time in my life, I worry that the people who say they're going to move to New Zealand or buy property in Australia, they may not be kidding. In fact, for the last 5 years, an increasing record number of Americans have renounced their citizenship. Now, some of them do that for tax reasons, but never before. There were tax reasons in prior eras, but it never took place before. Anything can happen. Anything can happen now in this political world of ours. The Brits leaving Brexit? This is a scary story. From the mainstream media, I can't believe the New York Times, this lower slide here. Her Majesty's jihadists. More British Muslims have left Britain to join ISIS than have signed up to serve in Her Majesty's military forces. It is truly a critical time in American history and in Western civilization. Eleanor had mentioned, I quote Casablanca. There's a great, great scene towards the beginning of Casablanca, you might remember. You've got Colonel Heinrich Strasser, the Nazis, at the table. And he turns to Rick Blaine, Humphrey Bogart, and says, "What is your nationality?" And Humphrey Bogart says, "Me? I'm a drunkard." And then the French captain says, "Well, that makes Rick a citizen of the world." Well, you kind of wonder today to how deeply patriotism is felt in people's bones. Or do many people feel now like they're citizens of the world? I call it the airplane test. Let's say an airplane is skidding down the runway. And before it begins to skid, you turn to passengers near you and say, "Hey, tell me about yourself." And what are they likely to say? One of them might say, "Well, I'm a fantasy football fanatic," right? Another person might say something like, "Well, you know, I'm getting the new iPhone as soon as it comes out," right? And another person might say, "Well, me, you know, I'm gluten-free, you know, and I..." "And I don't like the pretzels on this airline because they're gluten," right? And if the plane started skidding and there was a choice, what is one thing you're going to take with you? How many people would grab their iPhone or your fantasy football picks or your gluten-free muffins or an American flag? And I kind of worry that the American flag, and think about Iwo Jima, right? The American flag might not be anywhere near the top of the list of what people might say. Where have all the Habsburgs gone? Right? By the way, this is a great scene in Amadeus, Mozart. Remember the great scene where Franz Joseph listens to Mozart's latest composition and says to Mozart, "I like it quite a bit, but there were too many notes, too many." And Mozart says, "Well, Your Majesty, if you tell me which notes you didn't like, I guess I could take them out." Why do rich nations fall apart? What are the forces that can unravel them? Well, globalization can unravel countries. Debt, a failing work ethic, a change in the population, and a lack of patriotism. Those are the forces that we're grappling with now. We live in, I call it the age of anxiety. What movie is this from on the upper left? Network, great movie. Those of you college and high school kids, any of you have seen the movie Network? You're not a high school kid, you're older than I am. Wait a minute. You watched it on your wind-up TV, didn't you? I'm sorry, that's not. You guys need to watch Network. I showed it to my kids the other day. It is the most prescient movie ever made. It was made in 1976, around the same time that Sylvester Stallone made Rocky. I think it may have competed against Rocky that year. This movie foresaw reality television. In the story, and I'm afraid I'm going to go very quickly, but you guys are a super smart audience, so I can do that. So in the movie, he plays a national broadcaster, a newsman, someone like, you know, Tom Brokaw or Lester Holt or one of those mainstream media people, right? But it's 1970s, and he becomes an alcoholic, he becomes a drug addict. He's upset about OPEC and the oil embargo. He's upset about inflation and unemployment. This is pre-Reagan economy. And basically, he goes crazy on the air. And he says to the American people at the end of his news broadcast, he says, tune in next week, because I'm going to blow my brains out on the air. At which point the movie shows you the producers backstage who say, turn off his microphone, turn off his microphone. And one producer who imagined reality television decades earlier says, no, let him go. Think about the ratings we're going to get next week. So he goes on the air and he again goes crazy. He's like foaming at the mouth, enraged and disheveled. And he tells the American people, I want you to open up the nearest window and yell to your neighbor. Any of you remember what he yells?
I'm mad as hell. And I'm not going to take it
anymore. I'm mad as hell and I'm not going to take it anymore. Right? And there's this great scene. They pan down, I don't know, 3rd Avenue in Manhattan. And some white guy opens in the window. I'm mad as hell. I'm not going to take it anymore. Some black guy across the street opens his. I'm mad as hell. A Chinese guy. And I watched this with my kids a couple weeks ago, and I thought, there goes Bernie Sanders and Donald Trump. Because, look, in this country, whether you're a socialist or whether you're a capitalist, you feel something is wrong. Something has corroded. And each of those candidates' disparate views are telling us that Washington is corrupt and that our system needs to be straightened out. And this is creating anxiety across the country, and it slows down the economy. And to be honest, we can't expect that the business community is going to be creating patriotism in this country, because we live in this globalized world. How did we go from made in USA to made in wherever is cheaper? Look, around 1968, 1969, Boeing unveils the 747, this great engineering achievement. And they had marching bands, and they distributed cupcakes and so on, and all sorts of things, and flag waving. Why? Because 98% of that plane was manufactured in the USA. 98, but now, more recently, last few years, Boeing unveiled the 787. 40% of that plane is made in the USA. Why? Because Boeing needs to make sure it can sell to Alitalia, so part of the plane has to be made in Italy, and to Japan Airlines, part of the plane needs to be made, and so on. You know how this goes. And so we're not going to be expecting businesses in this globalized community to do the work that we must do to maintain this level, to maintain and enhance a level of patriotism. We also, beyond the question of business and so on, we are fighting this vicious disdain, this vicious attack on the free enterprise system across the world. God forbid you make more than the median income. You must be evil. God forbid your company made a profit. Why? You must have been. You know, the way these socialists and many liberal Democrats think, they see a fat person and a skinny person walking down the street, and they think, well, he's skinny because he ate up all his food. It's not a zero-sum game. That's not how the economy works. You have these fools in the Occupy movement. I was in Lower Manhattan last time they were out in force. They protest on behalf of 99% of the population, on behalf of the. And how do they show their support? They throw bricks through plate glass windows at Starbucks. Really, as if the problem for 99% of the population is the price of a cappuccino. But this is the way these people think. And one wonders, why don't we have a stronger economy? Well, we can list a whole number of reasons why we don't, emanating from the White House. But beyond that, if you've got a global economy where people are sneered at and attacked and nearly shackled or their front lawns marched on by protesters because they made more than 50% of the income, it's really hard to engage business and get a synchronized global recovery in that climate. In the book, I point out, I call it the paradox of theft. Now think about this. If we took a survey on State Street and we asked people two questions. How much money you got? No, I don't mean change, but I mean, you know, in your bank account, stocks. How much money do you have? And what percent of it do you use each month to pay off your debt? We would typically find that wealthier people are not strapped and not struggling to pay their monthly credit card bill. Now, that doesn't mean you can't have rich people who fall into bad situations. You know, the singer Meatloaf went bankrupt and 50 Cent went bankrupt and some other folks. So that happens. But typically, poor people have a tougher time, right? I mean, that's obvious. But when you look at countries, here's the paradox of theft. Rich countries are more likely to be badly in debt than poorer countries. Now, it's tough for you to see this map here, but basically what it shows you, the lower left, the southeast quadrant, the horizontal line, which my college kids, that's the x-axis or y-axis? Quickly. Good, good. This table gets extra dessert. We're showing debt as a percentage of GDP. The vertical line on the left, the y-axis is deficit. All you need to know is if you live in the southeast quadrant of this map, your country's in trouble, because that means it's highly indebted, and it's getting worse every year. Who's there? Greece, Japan, Ireland, Italy, France, the Eurozone, and the U.S. Who's in the enviable northwest quadrant of this map with low debt? Mexico. Yeah. You know the way Sarah Palin purportedly said that, you know, she knows a lot about foreign policy because she lives in Alaska and see Russia? She didn't really say that, but they claimed she... I live in San Diego. I can see Mexico from my house. I have to wait for Shamu the Whale to finish his little, you know, twirls. Mexico has better finances. I was in Mexico a couple weeks ago. Russia has less debt. Now, this has an impact on politics. Why do you think Vladimir Putin could strut bare-chested through Crimea without being challenged? Because he was not worried about borrowing on the international bond markets. Now, I have to confess to you, in the last couple of years, oil prices, oil prices, other commodities fell apart. Russia's now in a recession. So now if you see him without a shirt, he had to sell it at a flea market this morning. But this is the problem with the paradox of theft. We are stealing money from our children. This little photo here, I owe $26,351. This is what happens to rich countries. A little thought experiment here. We got to think, how do we get into this mess? Anyone here trace their ancestors to the Mayflower? Anyone do that? Oh, that was a quick, oh, quite a few. What was the family name?
Brewster.
Wow. I was in San Diego. Do you have relatives in San Diego? No, because Ron and I asked this question, and a woman with last name Brewster raises her hand. Is Brewster, New York, named after your family? Have you ever heard of Brewster, New York? Here's a real digression. Have you ever heard of the TV show That Girl with Marlo Thomas? It took place in Brewster, New York. These are your people, Marlo Thomas and Danny Thomas. So anyway, a little thought experiment. We're coming over on the Mayflower, right? It's 1620. It's rocky. It's stormy. We're going below deck. We're going to have a meeting because we got to come up with some rules. And the Brewster family says, all right, we're going to take notes. Let me have suggestions, they say. Some rules on how we're going to run this new community. Would any of us at that moment step forward and say, well, principle number one, one-third to one-half of us should not pay any taxes? Wouldn't that immediately doom this new community? Anyone here belong to a book club? Oh, good, I got a lot of books to sell. The Brewsters, you know, sign them. Could you have a... Think about this quite seriously. If you had a book club and half the people who belonged said, well, I'm not going to read that book. I'm not going to buy the book. But I'm showing up to your house next week and you better serve lobster tails and filet mignon. Could you have a book club survive? I don't think so. Can you have a country? I think we are about to test that proposition, and it's worrisome. Part of it is the demographics of death. These are my wife's grandparents. He just passed away at 102 a couple months ago. She's 101. This is from Valentine's Day. This past Valentine's Day, they were honored by the Marriage Encounter Group as the longest married couple in America. They'd been married. Listen, don't clap too loudly. They were Roosevelt Democrats, and so I used to sign them up for National Review and Commentary and all the magazine, Weekly Standard. Anyway, so they were celebrated. People are living longer, and that's wonderful. It's wonderful. But at the same time, when countries become wealthier, people have fewer babies. It's not just a phenomenon in the U.S. starting in the 1960s. It's taken place all throughout the world, even Mexico. I told you I was in Mexico 2 weeks ago. The birth rate in Mexico has now come down almost equivalent to the U.S., about 2 children per female. This is what happens when countries start moving up the income line. It's happened throughout history. But that creates a bit of a problem. You got people living longer. You got fewer young people. Who's going to do the work? Who's going to be the respiratory therapist in the hospital? Right? And then at that point, you need to be looking towards immigration. And here's the challenge. You need to have immigration, but how do you have immigration and keep your culture and your society and maintain your level of patriotism? That is an awesome, frightening task that the U.S. successfully performed for most of the 20th century. Taking in Irish, Italians, Jews, Germans, and throughout from 1860 till 1940, tens of millions that couldn't wait to wave the American flag and claim their allegiance. That's the problem we have. Look, the birth situation. We used to size up a man by counting his children. Now we count Rolex watches, six-pack abs, and Twitter followers. We have today, now this is, where's Alec, one of our friends here? Yes, Alec challenged me on this earlier. We have more, get this, golf courses now in this country than McDonald's. This is a sign of the aging population. More golf courses than McDonald's. In Japan, now this is queasy. I'm glad, you'll get queasy over this. I'm glad you've already had your lunch. In Japan, look at this lady on the right. In Japan, they sell more adult diapers than baby diapers. Look, she's so pleased. Why is this lady smiling? What has she done? How did we get into this mess? Look, Franklin Roosevelt and his advisors set the retirement age in the 1930s at 65. Why? Because in the 1930s, the average 65-year-old was dead. Yeah. In fact, he didn't live to age 65 himself. Now I want you to think of Lyndon Johnson, right? Pictures of Lyndon Johnson here. There's Lyndon Johnson. He sets the retirement age for Medicare at 65. Now look at the picture on the upper right. Get this. Do you realize Lyndon Johnson did not live to see age 65? Yeah, the senior prom, 21 years old. There he is, right? In fact, he died at age 64 several years after leaving the White House. People are living longer, and we can't support the entitlement system as it is. It just doesn't work. Immigrants. So this country is destined to have immigration, but the question is, how do you have immigration that's acculturated, right? That's not divisive. When we talked about debt, we talked about birth rates and a little bit about immigration. We also have this question of work ethic. There's the kid in mom's basement right there. I don't remember whether we did this slide yet. The labor participation, there we are. This chart on the right. Well, let me sum it up this way. Something's rolled over, right? That's the number of, 1 in 6 working age men ain't working. They're not looking. Millions of our compatriots wake up each morning, look in the mirror, and say, work, a job. It's not really my field, you know. This is what happens in wealthy society. Look, when a country becomes rich, and we are a rich society, people don't starve, people don't, you know, generally don't sleep in this. Everybody gets a comfy bed, but fewer people have a reason to get out of it in the morning. And that's one of the pathologies that we're facing up to. And during the Obama administration, those numbers have gotten worse and worse, strikingly worse. The labor participation rate is lower than it was in the 70s when women were, in many cases, denied the ability to enter professions. And the fact, so the labor participation rate now is worse than when so many women were denied the ability to enter the workforce. That tells you how critical the situation is. And then we've got the disability crisis. 11 million Americans, many of whom are able-bodied, collecting disability. I like quoting the mainstream media when every now and then they confess that there's a problem with liberal policies, because then they can't argue with it. So the New York Times front page story, the Long Island Railroad, nearly every retiree of the Long Island Railroad retired on disability. How did they figure it out? Well, the attorney general went to some golf courses, you know, and some bowling alleys and tennis courts, and that's where they found the employees. The work ethic, I think it starts early, and I think that's a problem. And when I was a kid, I worked after school in high school. I worked in the supermarket. I worked in the dairy department. Right? Now, what did I learn? Well, I learned this was important. The freshest milk is in the back, because that's where I learned also to wear a sweater. But I also learned to show up on time. I learned that when your boss expects you to be there, you must be there. And I developed an admiration for the moms and dads who are working full-time trying to feed their families while being, you know, the manager of the dairy department. It's hard work. And yet we don't demand that. Northeastern University had done a study that showed, especially in lower-income urban communities, those students who work after school or on weekends were less likely to get involved in crime, less likely to get involved in drugs, and less likely to be involved in teenage pregnancy. It's a good thing. They don't have the time. To which I now ask our young people, what are you doing here today? You really ought to be... did any of them volunteer to clear the plates? You know. Okay. The work ethic. We'll skip this here. Work ethic is affected by government policies. Our government discourages work, and sometimes discourages work among those trying to get a foothold in this challenging economy. We have a licensing epidemic. That is, you need a government license or permission to enter about one-third of the jobs in America, and it's expensive. In the state of Arizona, if you want to work in a beauty salon, if you want to braid hair, you have to go to beauty school for 1,600 hours. All right, that's like a year of training, but it's not like an apprentice. This is formal classroom training included. This means tens of thousands of dollars you must pay in order to enter that profession. And the government imposes this. In the same state, if you want to be a policeman, how many hours? 600 hours to become a policeman. 1,600 hours to braid hair, 600 to be a policeman. So according to our government, or at least the government of Arizona, it's much more dangerous to wield a Revlon blow dryer than a 40 caliber Glock. This is the government attacking the economy. I won't get into the housing crisis because I do want to save some time for questions and answers. Well, maybe I will a moment just to tell you, the real estate situation here in California, in that real estate bubble, the bankers didn't. Washington, D.C. told the bankers, lend to anyone, we'll take care of it. And that was Fannie Mae's job. Oh, by the way, this is an inside secret from Washington, D.C. Why is Fannie Mae located, every other major financial institution is located in a financial center? New York City, San Francisco, Chicago. Why is Fannie Mae in Washington, D.C.? I will tell you, and no one else will tell you this, it's so that Democrats, when they leave the White House and the Treasury Department, can make Wall Street millions without having to move their families out of Washington, D.C. So Fannie Mae has been stacked with Democratic officials at the highest level, including, for a long time, the CEO is a guy named Jim Johnson. Jim Johnson, what was his claim? He ran Walter Mondale's campaign in 1984. I don't know whether you've heard, but we've got some display around here. Mondale lost. So is it surprising that Johnson went on to lose, you know, billions of dollars for the rest of us taxpayers? So that's what, so the bankers. So what happened where I live in San Diego? You started with Mr. and Mrs. I deserve four bedrooms and a jacuzzi. I never saved a dime in my life. I deserve four bedrooms and a jacuzzi. They went to the banker. The banker didn't care. They didn't put any money down. They didn't even show their tax return to the bank. I asked one of the bankers where I live. I said, how is this possible? You lent money to Mr. and Mrs. I deserve four bedrooms and a jacuzzi. You didn't even see their tax return? The banker said, well, Todd, you got to remember the context. Everything was going up. We all were making money. We were behind in the paperwork. This was the clincher. And besides, he said, we didn't want to, you know, embarrass our customers. Embarrass? Yeah, this is a couple that would like be happy to go on the Jerry Springer show and wrestle each other on the ground. We're worried about embarrassing them? So the government not only racks up dangerous debt, it then encourages people to work less and rack up their own debt. Okay. Look, the Obama administration, you know, someday soon will be gone. They came in on a tank. When it comes from a business point of view, because you can't have jobs without having job creators, right? From a business point of view, Obama rode into town on a tank. He may not have been in favor of national defense, but he rode in town on a metaphorical tank. That would be the only tank he'd be familiar with, a metaphorical tank, surrounded by corpsemen. So he's riding in his metaphorical tank. He's got a turret that goes 360, and he points to every industry. He says, insurance and finance, bad, boom. Oil, gas, coal, bad, boom. Healthcare, boom. Chemicals, boom. Manufacturing, hotels, restaurant. And one by one picks off every industry, whether it's through taxation, through simply decrying them in public, or massive regulations. And then on top of it, you know, he and his supporters attack children because they imprison children in public schools from which those kids can't escape, and as a result of which they fall further and further behind the rest of the world and any of their cohort that were lucky enough to get out of public schools. In fact, we are in a race for IQ points across the world. Right? In the 1990s, beginning 2000s, the U.S. created a lot of jobs, right? Almost 20 million jobs. And if you add the 80s, Reagan era, we created another 20 million jobs. But we lost some jobs on the docks, timber, farmers, sewing, gain jobs, engineering, science, architects, legal assistants, financial services. This takes education. And we're failing our children. There are counties in this state with a high school dropout rate of nearly 40%. Look at the lower left photo. If you don't have a high school education in this globalized economy, you are competing against the last yak, the last peasant in Mongolia who yoked a yak to a plow. And you're probably competing against the yak. And I don't know whether you'll beat the yak. Especially if the yak's on steroids. So, patriotism. If it's not there, what happens? I think there's a kind of zero-sum game. There's a trade-off. If you don't have patriotism, you have narcissism. People look inward. As narcissism rises, patriotism goes down. The best way to develop self-esteem is what? To do something worthy of esteem. Not to stand around with a bunch of kids. Oh, you're so special. You're so special. You're so special. Oh, my Lord. It's, the future. Talk about narcissism. Did you see that wonderful photo of Hillary Clinton in a cage? You know, this was actually a parade float. Really?
Where was that? I want to move there.
Yeah, perfect. G.I. Joe. When I was a kid, I had a G.I. Joe. Just think of that name, G.I. Joe. Now, we know, you know, G.I.s, many of you served, I'm sure, and I salute you for that. The idea of a G.I. Joe, or the phrase a regular Joe, for people in the older generation, that was a compliment. He's a good guy, he's a regular Joe, we can talk to him, we can have a beer, you know, he'll watch my house when I go on vacation, he's a regular Joe. Now, how dare you say to a young person, well, he's just a regular kid. No, he's special. You can't possibly say he's a regular kid or a government issue kid, GI kid. There's a survey done that's been done for about 40 years of college age kids. And it asked them a number of questions to gauge their narcissism. Doesn't apply to anybody in this room, by the way. One of my favorite questions was, if you were on the Titanic, would you be entitled to go out on one of the first lifeboats? Well, 40 years ago, the answer was no, I'm not special. Now the answer is, oh, you bet. Sorry, Grandma. You know, get out of the way. I'm hopping in. There was, I'm not going to mention a certain quarterback who I think, you know. And all these morons who say, well, what do you think about it? Well, I think he has the right to. Of course he has the right. The question isn't, doesn't he have the right? We would all fight for his right to say what he wants. The question is, are you a fool? And the answer there is yes. So, George Foreman, when he won his Olympic gold medal, waved a little American flag. But more interesting than that, Usain Bolt is not American, he's Jamaican. Fastest man on earth. He was, I don't know whether any of you saw this, remarkable. You can call it up on YouTube. He was giving an interview to a reporter and then suddenly stops the interview, puts his fingers, wait, what was he waiting for? The national anthem, but not the Jamaican national anthem. He heard the Star Spangled Banner and said effectively, I want to show respect to that country. Quiet. Boy, if we have to depend on people and islands abroad to teach us lessons, well then, let's go ahead and do that. What a dangerous time it is in the world. What a dangerous time. You turn on the TV, where are these rockets coming from? Gaza? Syria? Ukraine? You know, I was at a meeting with former Prime Minister Tony Blair. I said, Mr. Prime Minister, I think Vladimir Putin's auditioning for a movie role. And Blair said, what do you mean? I said, I think he's going to be the villain in the next James Bond movie. No, he's looking for that. He's got an agent in Hollywood. There he is, right? Can you find the mistake? Francis Scott Key, Star Spangled Banner. Oh, say, does that Star Spangled Banner yet wave over the land of the free and the home of the brave? Anyone see a mistake? No. Oh, you're right. There are two mistakes. Boy, these Brewsters, you know, they come early, 400 years early. You're also related to Francis Scott Key. All right. So you're right. Oh, say, does it, wait. No. This is correct. No. I'm sorry, Miss Brewster. It is correct. The end of the song is, oh, say, does that star. No, there's a different mistake. Back to Brewster. Anyone know? It's missing something. No. It's missing the question mark. What is your name?
Caroline.
It's missing the question mark. He wrote that, right? He wrote that as the bombs, Fort McHenry, Baltimore, and it was a question. Is the flag still there? Does this country still stand? And it wasn't a theoretical question because he knew there was a Republic of Genoa in 1814 that lasted 211 days. There was a Republic of Belgium in 1790. It only made it 325 days. It would not be surprising if the Declaration of Independence had been signed in 1776 and the British took it back, as Francis Scott Key wrote the Star-Spangled Banner. We are vulnerable. We are fragile. What can we do about it? We've got to start with children. We've got to start in our schools. You know, I've read now about schools around the country that have given up the Pledge of Allegiance to the United States of America and have substituted, "I pledge allegiance to the earth and all the life which it supports, one planet in our care, irreplaceable, with sustenance and respect for all." You know, like Ronald Reagan, I like the earth. I like the ground. You know, I like the plants. I like the birds. But if our country ceases to exist, the seagulls will still be flying over the beach. The waves will still be rolling in and rolling out again. But it's the country that's fragile, not the earth. School in Brooklyn sends out an announcement: Thanksgiving celebration is canceled because it might be deemed offensive to members of our community who don't celebrate Thanksgiving. Here's how I think about it. As we try to integrate immigrants, as we try to maintain respect for our country and our history, we have to be looking at our history, warts and all. Obviously, we've got some pockmarks, you know, to say the least, in our history, but that's okay. Every country does. We're a country made up of human beings, not gods, right? James Madison said, if men were angels, we wouldn't need government. So we're not angels. But we must embrace our history. And here I see a kind of dual obligation. I believe that immigrants to the United States should embrace American history and feel as if they too were with the Brewsters on the Mayflower, right? That they too were with Jefferson and Lincoln and Reagan, right? But at the same time, those of us who are lucky enough to be born here, we should be looking at immigrants and saying, you know what? You are entitled to feel that way. You should feel just as entitled to celebrate Thanksgiving as any old Yankee who came over on the Mayflower. And that's a dual obligation. And I think in this country, we've kind of lost both sides of it. One of the proposals I have in The Price of Prosperity, I would demand that any applicant for immigration get his or her passport stamped, not just at LAX or the port of entry, but at least 5 historical sites throughout the country. I would insist that students, U.S.-born students, who want a government loan or a student loan, they also should be required to get their passport stamped across the country. Now, if you go, "Oh, it's too expensive," I don't care. I don't beg, borrow, steal. If you can't get yourself on a Greyhound across the country, then I look at you and say, you know what? I don't think you've got the resourcefulness or the fortitude or the guts to do anything with your high school or college degree anyway. So you might as well stay on mom's basement sofa. So I think we've got to think about ways to inculcate a sense of our history. By the way, some positive notes. The Broadway musical Hamilton, and Eleanor mentioned I was affiliated with Jersey Boys. Hamilton, now I know, you know, they had a fundraiser for whatever. But this is an uplifting story, if you're lucky enough to get a ticket. And, you know, rap is not my thing, which I'm sure will surprise you. but in this story, it's largely an African-American, Hispanic-American cast. But they are performing as the Founding Fathers with respect, and doing so with lots of intricacy and sophistication, and they are effectively saying, we too, we are Hamilton, we are Jefferson, we are George Washington. We want to be American history, and we embrace it. And that, I think, is the kind of attitude and the sign of hope that I would see, that we can reconstitute this country in a way that gives us a stronger social fabric that can fight against so many of the forces that would try to rip us apart. At the end, the last chapter of the book, I propose something I call the Patriotist Manifesto. Now, we all know the word patriot, right? You're all patriots. What is a patriotist? I kind of made up the word. A patriotist, well, look at it this way. Right now, for many college students, if you say, I love my country, your professor will say, why? Why should you? You should, you know, just because you're an American, you should love Canada. You should love New Zealand. You should love, you know, Ghana as much as your own. Why is America entitled to your affection more so than your own? And if you look at American history, there's one professor, University of North Carolina, who teaches a course on the literature of 9/11. And he calls the U.S. not a superpower, he calls it a necropower. Now, the word necro comes from Greek meaning death, right? I think a patriotist is someone who believes, as a matter of principle, it is a good thing to love your country. And so I propose an 8-point patriotist manifesto. One of the lines of that is, a nation's character does not stem from the rocks and soil, but from the precepts the people will fight for. So I encourage you, if you get the book, look at the Patriotist Manifesto. I actually think YAF should print it out, put your logo on it, and distribute it to schools. Okay, take away, share the Patriotist Manifesto, support YAF, tell your stories of heroism. Let me close this way. I told this story in La Jolla a couple days ago, and we got a nice response. This is about participating in your community. So the Florida State Lottery is $14 million. Harry goes to church. He says, Father, let me win. I'll do good things. Nothing happens. $120 million the next week. My God, please let me win. I'll do good things. I'll volunteer. I've been a good son, nothing. Next week, $291 million. Harry is on his knees. He says, God, please, I'll build a new wing on the hospital, a new wing on the church, a new wing on the school. Just let me win. A booming voice from the heavens. Harry, meet me halfway. At least buy a ticket. So you all hold a ticket to the future of this country. Whoever you are, whoever your relatives, and we all hold a ticket to this country. It is a precious thing. It is a fragile thing. And there are fewer institutions that do more good to keep this fragile country going and trying to go in the right direction, literally and figuratively, than Young America's Foundation. So I'm so pleased to be with you. I look forward to your questions. Thank you. Thank you.
All right, Alec and I have microphones. If you have a question, please raise your hand. If you're a student, please give your name and school.
Hi, my name is Lynn Kirst. Thank you for a wonderful talk.
Thank you.
When you were speaking about Fannie Mae and the loan crisis, it brought back a recent memory. I have a very close girlfriend with whom I've been friends since high school. We both went to high school together here in Santa Barbara a couple of years ago. And she retired just a few weeks ago as a vice president of Fannie Mae. Needless to say, we do not discuss politics or Fannie Mae to maintain our many decades of friendship. But last year, she told me that she traveled a lot in her job, and she told me that she was going to Seattle to meet with some banks there that are at the forefront of providing loans that comply with Sharia law. And I was shocked out of my shoes to hear her say that. And she said, oh no, Seattle and the Pacific Northwest is really the leader in the country in providing mortgage loans that comply with Sharia law. So I didn't explore it further with her, but I'm curious if you know anything about
this. I'm not aware of that. I mean, I could imagine that Fannie Mae has certain, I mean, to put the best gloss on it, all right? So if I'm defending it, and I don't know much about this example, I could imagine a situation where Fannie Mae says, all right, these are the rules for anyone to have a mortgage. And some private bank or private entity says, all right, we've got, you know, some Muslim borrowers, so we're going to try to design something for them that complies with Sharia and also at the same time, you know, fulfills Fannie's requirements. You know, what can I say? It's Fannie Mae, even at its best, is the worst. And now you've given an example that we need to look into because it sounds sort of worrisome. I do have to apologize. I am getting, you'll be able to wave goodbye to me on the 204 departure from the station. So we've got time for questions, but we'll be crisp with them because it's a long drive to San Diego. Yes, sir. Oh, that's tricky because it requires me to discuss comparative advantage, which is an economic principle that basically says that countries ought to focus on producing what they produce best. I'm not convinced that that comparative advantage is going away. I actually think that there are elements based on natural resources and based on talent where countries do certain things better. Look, Silicon Valley does a pretty good job designing technology. And for all the other parts of the world that said, oh, well, we can create our own Silicon Valley. All right, some have done a little bit. So anyway, I don't buy the premise that it's going away, but it's a very sophisticated question. And I suggest you buy my first book. No.
Question over here.
Yes.
Hi, my name's Diana Aguilar, and I'm from Allen Hancock College. And I was just wondering what you think that us as students should do to encourage patriotism in our schools.
I know very few high schools or junior high schools or even elementary schools that would turn down college students from offering to come in to talk about some American heroes. If I were you, I would organize something and say, we'd love to come in and give a little talk. Start with Harriet Tubman. There's not a, I mean, Harriet Tubman, admirable, brave person, right? Those Second Amendment fans, you know, are particularly attached to her Second Amendment support. There's no school in this country that's going to say, oh, no, we wouldn't want you coming in to talk about Harriet Tubman and freeing slaves. And then after Harriet Tubman, you can start talking about some other American heroes as well. I think that's sort of small scale. You can look at it as an incursion, you know, but it's worth doing, and it does a service to the children. So that's, you know, that first idea comes to my head. Okay.
One more. Have you read the essay that was just published at Cambridge Review of Books, The Flight 93 Election? And if you have, could you comment on it?
I have not read it, but my friend Mark here briefed me on it. And I do the Flight 93 Election, another, as I understand it, and if I get it wrong, it's all Mark's fault. As I understand it, we all know this is a critical election. If the status quo stays, this country will have difficulty avoiding a terrible, tragic unraveling. So therefore, action must be taken. Look, Edmund Burke said, all that it's necessary for evil to triumph is for good men to do nothing. All that's necessary, I would say, for patriotism to fail is for parents and colleagues and friends not to discuss American heroes with each other. So I think the essay sounds fascinating. Thank you very much.
Well, again, thank you, Todd, for those compelling remarks. When you think about patriotism and how many members of Barack Obama's economic brain trust are saying that the answer to the economic woes that face our country is patriotism. is that even a part of the discussion? I suspect it's not. If you appreciated what Todd had to say, if you're a young person, I would encourage you, one of the things you can do is actually bring Todd to your campus. If you're a high school or college student here, talk to Young America's Foundation. I know many of you are already engaged with what we're doing. Consider bringing Todd to your campus and getting his book in front of more young people. If you support Young America's Foundation, I hope you enjoy coming to these luncheons. I hope you enjoy the speakers we bring in. Please don't leave it there. You can help us send Todd and speakers like Todd into classrooms, onto college campuses across the country through YAF chapters and through Young America's Foundation. I encourage you to talk to me or talk to my colleagues about how we can work together to do that. Todd had promised to stay and sign copies of his book. Obviously, if he's going to make that 205 train, that is not going to happen. I do want you to leave with Todd's book, though. So why don't we do this on the fly? If you leave with a copy of the book, also leave your name with us. I'm going to depend on Amy to get a clipboard or something, and we'll send Todd some book plates. Okay, they're all signed. Okay, they're pre-signed. So if you want a special inscription then, because I still want to encourage the books, we'll send Todd some book plates that we can get to you to place in your book. Pre-signed is great. So please do pick up a copy of The Price of Prosperity. There's some information on the back of your programs about upcoming Young America's Foundation programs back at our headquarters office and here at the Reagan Ranch Center. I encourage you to take a look at that. Again, thank you for being with us today. Look forward to seeing you again soon.